Welcome to the Mullen Automotive Museum. We have a special treat for you today. Alan Taylor is here to speak to you about the art of exotic automotive restoration. Alan started the Alan Taylor Company in 1990, specializing in pre-war European cars. For decades, he has been earning many best-in-show and best-in-class honors for his clients at major events, including the prestigious Pebble Beach Concours d'Elegance. Alan is a craftsman and artist that is recognized worldwide. His work has been displayed at the New York Museum of Modern Art, Kennedy Center, and the Smithsonian, among others. Today, in addition to cars, he is now producing a line of custom-fitted luggage to complement your automobile, yacht, or private plane under the brand name of TaylorMade Automotive Luggage. So please join me inside the theater to welcome Alan Taylor.
Are we all here? Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming today. We do appreciate you being here. I'm Alan Taylor. I'm a restorer. Some people say I just play and get paid for it.
When you look at some of the cars that were built in the 30s, in Europe in particular, the styling is just outrageously beautiful. And when you look around this wonderful museum, you see all of the French cars and all the French designers represented here. It's magnificent. There's nothing any more beautiful than a French design car. The Italians are wonderful. They make beautiful cars too, but it's nothing like the French. Now, of course, Bugatti was an Italian living in France, so you get a little combination of both there. The art of restoration is just that. It is an art form. We are craftsmen, we are artists, and we approach an automobile as an art form. It's rolling art. Out in the front, you will have seen some books on the table that are documents of the cars that we have restored. We give one of those books to the owner of the car when we finish his car, and that stays with the car as a living document showing what was done to their automobile and why. And it also allows us to have a reference book in our library so that when we have another automobile of a similar type, we have a reference book to go back to. And it's hard to find reference books for 1930s vintage European cars. A lot of them were destroyed during the war, and a lot of them were actually never built, never made. Coach-built cars, does everybody understand what a coach-built car is? When they started building automobiles, the engineer would send the chassis that he built to a coach builder who would build the body, because he was not a body builder. He was a designer, a mechanical engineer. Even today, there are still coach-built cars. One of the last of the coach-built cars in America was Cadillac. Fisher Body Company and Fleetwood were two of the last of the major coach builders in the United States. When we get a new project in the shop, first thing that we do is inventory the car or the vehicle. As you can see, this is an old Seagraves fire truck. And we start dismantling, disassembling it, taking it apart piece by piece. And as we take it apart, we examine each piece. We make an inventory. We decide what needs to be repaired. We start cleaning up the pieces and the parts. And it's you never know what little treasure you're going to find in there. I've actually taken manifolds off of engines and found rat's nests up inside of them. And actually, the most popular place for mice and field rats is in the muffler. It's a nice, cozy, warm spot, and they enjoy it in there. The disassembly process can take a matter of hours, a matter of days, or a matter of weeks. Piece by piece, it comes apart. A lot of cleaning. Cleaning is probably the most time-consuming part of the disassembly. You have to get all the grease and the dirt and the grime off of it. And my goodness, sometimes the crud that you find in these parts is just unbelievable. We start stripping the paint off. We disassemble chrome parts, lights, electrical components. We get down to the very nitty-gritty of each part. The interior parts sometimes come apart with the chrome and with a variety of pieces of the car. And sometimes there's no rhyme or reason for what we're taking apart at any one given time. You can see this transmission coming apart. When we disassemble a car, we break it into three pieces, three components: the body, the chassis, and the interior. We separate them and move them to different parts of the shop, where we finish the disassembly and start on the reassembly or the cleaning up and the restoration of the component parts. We do a little bit of everything in-house, including our woodwork. This dash that's going together right now is part of a fire truck that's been cut down into a roadster, a car that ran the great race. We rebuilt it for the customer, and he used it as his volcano car. He lived at the 3,500-foot level of Haleakala volcano on Maui, and he wanted something that was big and loud and boisterous that he could run up and down the volcano in. And so this is the car that we built for him. He loved what we built and had a great time with it, and it was a very impressive car. In fact, one of the most fun automobiles that I have ever driven. Here you see some of the problems that we have with the getting cars that have been sitting for many, many years outside. This frame was very rusty in places. It was even rusted through, and we had to cut little sections out here and there and put patch panels in. So we cut the rusty part out and we build a new piece of metal that fits perfectly and weld it back into the frame. Now, when we're doing this sort of work, the fit and finish is everything. And it needs to look authentic. It needs to be covered up to the point to where when you look at it after it's painted, you can't tell that anyone has modified it or replaced a part. We're getting into some really interesting projects from time to time. The pumpkin-colored Type 46 Bugatti out here, as received in our shop. That Type 46 came from a little island off the coast of Greece, where it spent most of its life. During the war, it was walled up inside of a garage and hid from the Nazis. After the war, they pulled it out and started cleaning it up and decided to rebuild the engine. Well, there really weren't what you would call good automotive mechanics around at that particular time in that particular part of the world. So most of it went to the local blacksmith. And the engine needed new wrist pins, and pistons, and a lot of parts. When we took this engine apart, we discovered that the wrist pins, that's the pin between the piston and the connecting rod, had riflings in it. And we looked at that and thought about it for a minute, and all of a sudden it dawned on me that the outside dimension, or the inside dimension of those riflings, was 50 caliber. They took a 50 caliber machine gun barrel, cut it into sections, and made wrist pins out of it. And it worked. It worked. It worked fine. For a period of time, anyway. But it's fun turning some of these cars, these old relics, into beautiful pieces of rolling art. We do all kinds of woodwork and repair work in our shop, and some we send out. Steering wheels, we repair some of them in-house and some of them we send to people who specialize in a particular type of steering wheel.
And we find that it's just a great deal more convenient and cost-effective. Wiring is another project that has to be dealt with on an individual basis depending on the type of car. Because the Europeans had a different type of look to their wire than the Americans had. They were all about the same, but they were still a little different type of look. We have had, at times, we have bought string or yarn, sent it to the manufacturer, and had wiring made with our color of yarn that we wanted for a particular project. It's a very doable, it's very, very, very doable. It's just that most people don't know that you can do that. Small parts are really what I enjoy working on personally. I'm at an age where I like to work on something that I can sit down at a bench and work on. My days of crawling underneath a car and up under the dash are just about past. I say just about because I still do it on occasion. Sometimes we're able to buy really nice parts that are all finished and ready to go. And sometimes we buy parts that look like they're finished and ready to go, but they're really not. And so it's a judgment call every time we go to put a part on a car that we have not restored completely. Fitting all of the parts to the car as we go along starts with fitting the body down to the chassis. And making sure that it is absolutely in the correct position. Now, we've put bodies on chassis and we've found that they had to be shimmed where we didn't think they had to be shimmed, but something would happen during the process of the body work and paint that it moves around. And you set the engine in, the transmission, and you put the tires and wheels on and you set it down on the ground, and all of a sudden, something tweaks. So we even go to the point so far to jack up opposite corners of a car to make sure that it doesn't have so much flex that a door binds when you open it. And that's very important, because if you park your car on a hill or a little bit of an angle and you go to open the door on a brand new restoration, you can chip the paint. So fit is absolutely essential on the finished car. And sometimes we have to modify it and repaint an area on the car. And that's just the way life is. This particular car that you see going together right now is a Type 46 Bugatti that had been in storage since the early 50s. When we got it, the body had been sitting on the ground in a barn with a dirt floor. And when we picked it up, it almost fell apart in pieces. The termites had eaten everything except the very outside shell of the wood. And so it just had a very thin shell of wood that looked like a nice strong piece of wood, but it was paper thin. So as we picked things up, we would hear a crack, and we'd grab it, and we'd tie something together. We got a whole bunch of big zip ties and some rope and duct tape, and we zip tied, duct taped, and roped it all together so that we could keep it in one piece. We got it to the shop, and we made patterns, and we had an entire new wood body frame built for this car, except for the doors, which were stored separately and off the ground. There was not a single piece of wood in the body that was usable. This particular car had won best of show at the Paris Concours in 1930. It also won Ladies' Choice. It won Most Elegant. And I believe it won one other trophy. But it made a clean sweep of the 1930 Concours d'Elegance of Paris. It was a beautiful car.
It was used by the coach builder as his personal driver and his show car for approximately 3 years before it was sold. So the first registered owner of the car, I believe, was in 1933, although the car was built in 1930. We find this from time to time on American cars and European cars, where they've been used for shows or displays, or the owner of a factory has used it as his own personal driver. It's fun to see those sorts of things and to do the research and find the history on the vehicles. Forensics are some of the most exciting parts of the restoration. This particular car, we really weren't sure what color it was, but the build sheet said that it was ocean. That's the only color that it had, was ocean, with black wings. And as we started taking this body apart, underneath some of the metal parts, the chrome pieces on the door jams and underneath the original carpet in a couple of spots, we found the seafoam green paint. And we pulled that out and we took it to a paint supplier that had the ability to examine it under a microscope and come up with the exact color. So this color that's on this car, as you have seen it in these pictures, is seafoam green with black wings, and that is the absolute identical color of the car as delivered. Now we get into some parts for plating. Plating is probably one of the most expensive and troubling parts of a restoration. Most people don't understand what it takes to replate an entire set of chrome for a car. And the different types of plating, there's nickel, there's zinc, cad, chrome, and chrome actually has a couple of different colors. When you chrome plate, you need to chrome plate everything at one time. Everything from the interior at one time, everything from the exterior at one time, so that all of the chrome on the outside matches and all the chrome on the inside matches. Otherwise, you end up with a rainbow. The repairs that have to be done to the parts before they're chrome plated are sometimes immense. We strip the parts down to either the bare steel or bare brass or whatever they're made of. Sometimes they're die cast or aluminum. And from that point, we make all of the repairs that have to be made. We fit all of the parts and pieces back together again. So when the car is in its final primer before it's painted, we bring all of the chrome parts back into the shop that have been stripped, repaired. Sometimes we have them coppered before we do this, and we fit them to the body, the primered body. Once they fit the primered body, then we send them back out to be chrome plated. Once they are chromed, then we paint the car and we do one final fitting before we put the chrome back on the car for the last time. Usually there's plenty of room between the paint and the chrome to make a nice fit. Very seldom do we have to go back and do any massaging after the fact. Paint is also a huge issue, and painting a car is not just sanding it, scuffing it, putting some primer on it, painting it, and saying, there you are, it's a beautiful car. We spend sometimes as much as 1,000 hours preparing the car for paint. That is, from the time that the bodywork is finished to the time that we put the paint on the car, can be as much as 1,000 hours. And every car is different. It depends on the size, it depends on the condition, and what you're painting and where. But an average is about 1,000 hours. Now you multiply that times $100, you have $100,000 for a paint job. And customers will look at us and say, are you crazy? You know, I can get the same thing done for $10,000 across the street. Well, if you can, more power to you. Take it across the street, because we sure can't do it for that. But what you get in a quality shop and what you get from the shop down across the street or down the street are two entirely different things. It's the difference between buying a heart valve and or going down to the auto parts store and buying a hot water valve and having it put in your chest. You know, it's a valve, but it's not going to last long. Sometimes we still use a brush and a can of paint. On the interior wood, parts that are getting covered up with upholstery, or parts that are not seen, wood parts that are not finished wood, we do use a brush and a can of paint. And paint them flat black, and we make sure that the wood is well saturated so that it preserves the wood. We used to do all of our paint work in-house, and we've found that there are so many really good paint shops out there in our area that we have contracted with a paint shop in Escondido to do all of our paint work. And I find that we have a really good working relationship with the paint shop, and they do things the way we want them done. I'm kept in the loop. I'm there every day when they're working on our cars. I'm following it just like I do when it's in my own shop. This is really the best way, the most economical way to complete a restoration. Once the car is all primed and masked off and in the paint booth, it has to be wiped down one more time, because there's always a chance of something getting on the body as it's pulled into the paint booth. If you're pushing on it, you get a little oil from your hands, and that'll create fish eyes. So it's really a surgical atmosphere inside the paint booth. The paint is ready to go on the car, the final paint. The painter is very meticulous, very slow process, and it takes a lot of time to put it on smooth and even and make it flow out right. A good painter, takes an entire day to paint a car. And it's not just a quick, easy run in the paint booth and shoot it, because you have to make sure that all of the edges are covered. Upside, underside, backside, inside, outside, wherever there's an edge that could possibly be seen or touched or felt by human hands, that paint has to be on in the proper thickness and in a manner that is smooth and even to the touch and smooth and even to the eye. It's not amazing to me. I've started to say it was amazing to me how many people want to come look at their car being painted. But I can understand that. I like to see the work in action. And it's fun, it's exciting to see something coming together that you have thought about and dreamed about for 10, 15, 20 years. And then to open the doors on the paint booth and see your car painted, something that you have owned for a long period of time, that you have dreamed about having, and here it is, painted and ready to go back together. Now that's a milestone. It's a milestone in the restoration. It's a milestone for the owner of the car. It's a milestone for us as the restorers. And we really enjoy and we appreciate the owner's interest in the car and the restoration. Here you can see this Type 46 Bugatti body painted. You can see the new wood on the inside in the roof. All of that will get painted black or clear, one or the other, but it'll get coated before the car is finished. So now it comes time to do the final sanding on the paint. The paint has to be what we call color sanded. We use very, very, very fine sandpaper and a variety of tools and equipment to do the sanding with, but it's all by hand, no machines. So if there's a blemish or a spot of dirt, it's sanded first with perhaps a 1,000 grit paper, and then we take it to a 1,500 and then to a 2,000 grit paper before the car is polished. And then it's polished after the fact, or after it has been color sanded. And that's where you get the luster, where the surface is perfectly flat. There's no orange peel, there's no blemishes, there's no ups and downs, hills or valleys. It is perfectly smooth. We have been the recipient of the McGuire's Award on several occasions for our paint jobs and are very proud of that. We have had very nice work come out of our shop. We always get the car running with the least amount of body sheet metal back on the car as possible, with just the main body section. If we can get the car running, we can drive it, we can test drive it, we can make sure that nothing is rubbing, nothing is dragging. There is nothing more upsetting and irritating than to find out as you drive out the driveway and hit a bump that a tire hits the inside of the fender and burns the paint on the outside. And that's a really, really expensive mistake. And so we just don't do that sort of thing. Sometimes we put the chassis together and actually just drive the chassis by itself. And from time to time, we take these running chassis to shows because they're so interesting. They are a piece of art. They're beautiful, and you can see everything and how it works and how it moves and runs. And a lot of people have never seen a bare running chassis without a body on it. And so to the general public, it's always interesting. And it's always fun to show off your work that way, too. We all have egos, and we all have pride in what we do. And we like to show off a little bit. The upholstery sometimes is on the outside of the car as well, as you can see the trunk and the top on this car. And what I'm talking about making things fit and work without having the car all together, you can see that there's a clearance issue at times on the tires and wheels. So we have to make sure that it all fits. The interiors on these cars are works of art in themselves. The craftsmen that did the upholstery on the early cars in particular were craftsmen left over from the horse and carriage trade. These guys did everything by hand. Everything was hand sewn. And sometimes it becomes a real chore for us to duplicate what they've done. We're very fortunate in that we get and we have had really good representations of the spring units and the underlayment of everything that we have, so we know what to build and how to build it. And we can put it back just exactly like it was built in the beginning. When we start building up the units, then we have to put them together, put them on the seat frames, on and off, making sure that they fit, that there's clearance, that they look the same, that we're getting the same amount of padding, we're getting the same amount of spring, and it's extremely time-consuming. Now, this particular car that you see the pictures of now,
The interior of that car was done originally in suede. And so we had some suede made up of what we assume was the same color. The way they spoke of it on the in the original build sheet. And then we built the seats up by hand, just like they did in the late 30s, or the late 20s, early 30s, when they made these interiors. You can see it going together. You see all the string and all the hand sewing. That's really time consuming. But it makes a beautiful finished product when it's all done, and it sits comfortably. You sit on it and it feels altogether different from anything that you get today. It feels more like a piece of furniture that you have in your home, a really expensive piece of furniture. The detail in the sewing and the design lines and the accents, we have special sewing machines that cover all of that, that allow us to make that type of distinction on them. The finished details of a car are just that. They are the finished details. And you can spend hundreds of hours, literally hundreds of hours, doing all the little detail work and the finish up, making all the little stuff fit and look pretty and be aligned. When you put screws where the heads show, you want the screws to line up. You want the slot in the screws to line up. If it's a horizontal piece, you want the slots horizontal. If it's a vertical piece, you want the slots in the screws vertical. And that's the difference between winning and not winning, is the detail. And we are very good at detail work. There was three French cars and one Italian car there. And we don't apologize for the Italian car. It just is. It can't help it. Our cars have been major events all over the United States and Europe. And we have appreciated so very, very much our customers who have made it possible for us to work on these wonderful works of art. Now here's a Minerva. This is a Minerva AL, 1930 or 31. Take a look at it. This is the way we received it. It came to us in this particular condition. Looks pretty decent, doesn't it? Not bad at all. But this car took an enormous amount of work. About 15,000 hours to restore this car. Once we got it all apart and got all of the Bondo off of it, we found that it was just absolutely rotten in a lot of places, and we had to make an awful lot of patch panels for it. This is the trunk, and this is the new color. This is when it's finished, and you can see that we just restored the original wood, but replaced all the leather and restored the interior trim parts and the chrome and the silver. The car was absolutely gorgeous and it did extremely well. It won runner-up best of show at Pebble Beach. It took multiple best in show awards around the country. And you see the little clearance light up above the, or up beside the windshield. I want to tell you a quick funny story about that as we finish up these particular slides. Those two glass turn indicator lights, one of them was broken. And I looked and I looked and I looked for about a year and a half for one of those lights and could not find it. Talked to everybody that I knew in Europe that dealt in electrical parts. This car was built in Belgium, bodied in Belgium, and it had Belgium lights on it. I went to Retromobile about a year and a half into the restoration of this car, and a friend of mine met me at the door, and he said, "Alan, are you still looking for
for that little red light? And I said, yes. And he said, well, follow me. And we walked down the aisle, and we came to a booth, and there was a table about 10 feet long and 3 feet wide. And it was just a sea of red lenses and lights. And he reached over, and he picked this lens up, and he handed it to me. He says, is this it? And I said, that's it. And it was new old stock. And I just thought I'd died and gone to heaven. And to find that, we were getting ready to send it out and have it duplicated in acrylic. But we were able to get original glass lenses. Now, the last few slides that you've seen are cars that we have restored, that we've shown, and they're at shows in these slides. We've had, they're wonderful cars. We love them, and it's so fun. And it's fun for me to see them on these slides and to see them all together. You know, we work on this stuff all the time, and it just kind of comes and it goes, and it comes and it goes, and seldom do we really get a chance to stop and admire what we've done. And I tell my guys, I tell them, I say, you are artists, you're craftsmen, you're the best, and you're the best of the best. It's really nice to be able to see what we've done over a period of time all together in one picture. And it's nice to be able to show my guys in the shop what they have accomplished over a period of a couple of years. They are truly artists, and these guys deserve a whole lot more recognition than they get. This car actually has a bar inside of it on one side of the rear seat, and on the other side it has a library of maps and some miscellaneous books. And that was original, but it also had a cover that covered up the bar and it, with a zipper along the top edge so that the bar was not open all the time. If they drove to an area where it was not legal or ethical to have open liquor in your car, all they had to do was just zip up the zipper and it was covered, and that was it. This last picture is from the Concorde d'Elegance at La Jolla, California, and where this particular car won Best of Show. This car has been to a number of shows here in California, and has done extremely well, and it belongs to a local San Diego family. This is all original, and the silver inlay that you saw in there was actually sterling silver. Here's a car that you'll recognize that's sitting out here in the lobby. It's the Type 50 with the Stingray interior in it. Beautiful, beautiful Type 50 Bugatti. Peter called me not too long ago and said, Alan, I'd like to put this Type 50 Bugatti that you're working on in Pebble Beach. And he said, can you get it ready in time? And I said, of course. And so we just kind of threw everybody at it. And he said, I don't want it so pretty and so pristine that it looks new. He said, the car has been driven and used, and it's a wonderful old car. He said, I just want it massaged, and I want a lot of patina left on the chassis. And so we did. And actually, some of that black paint that you see is original. It's from the last paint job that it had some years back. We repainted the green, and we repainted, I think we repainted the hood. And that was about it for the paint on that car. But we did the top and the interior. We have approximately 60 Stingray skins on the inside of this car. We've matched some fabric to the color of the Stingray skins. The glossy appearance that you see on these skins are because we had the skins sanded, and about 50% of the thickness of the nodules on the back of the Stingray have been removed. So it makes a very slick, smooth surface. We received these in a bleached white color and then hand-dyed each skin by itself.
Now you notice that there is a variation in the color, and that's because every animal has a little bit different coloration to its hide. And so you have, with an aniline dye, which is very clear, you have a variation in color, and that's part of nature. And that's why we left it that way. And the car was extremely well received at Pebble Beach. Everybody loved it, and there was a crowd around it all day. And it won third in class. And the other two cars were absolutely pristine cars that were completely restored, recent restorations. And it's very difficult to compete with that sort of thing. But for a third in class, that was really, really good and really fitting for this particular car. And I got to take it on the tour, and it was really fun to drive. As many of you know, I got my start in this industry as an apprentice to my father, who was an automobile upholsterer. He was a fabulous artist in his trade and well recognized around the country, and actually had customers from a number of places around the world. This trophy with the hammer and scissors on it is the Aubrey Taylor Award of Excellence in Craftsmanship for the Best Upholstery at the La Jolla Concours. These are some sculptures that I have done in recent years, and we have used some of them as trophies at the La Jolla Concours. And in fact, here at the Mullen Museum, there's a large one that was best of show for last year. I am was a starving artist many years ago and supplemented my income doing metal sculptures. It did reasonably well with it, but I couldn't see a real future in it at that time. And so I went back to doing automobile upholstery and some manufacturing of upholstery interior kits, and did quite well with it at that time, back in the 70s. The next few shots that you see are just beauty shots, things that I thought you would enjoy seeing. There's On the Ramp at Pebble Beach. I think this is Coronado Concours. There's another Pebble Beach shot, but these are just all beauty shots. So let's just enjoy looking at some rolling art and appreciate what you're seeing. Appreciate the artistry involved in creating these cars. If there are any questions, I will be happy to answer them shortly, and we'll have a question and answer period here in just a little bit. We've found that with the bulk of our restorations, our customers have asked us to include custom fitted luggage for their cars. So we have built custom fitted luggage for the cars that we've restored for many years. We have recently added on to that and made a special department in our shop for custom fit luggage for all cars, antiques and brand new cars as well. Typically, all it takes is a drawing with dimensions of the area that the luggage fits into in order for us to build a custom set of luggage for your car. You can see here that Juan is laying out the leather to make these suitcases for this Aston Martin DB4. We were lucky enough to be able to get a set of pictures from an original set out of England. Actually, it's the only original set of luggage for a DB4 that I've ever seen. It was four pieces, and we got some really good close-ups of the stitching, of the interior, of the latch assemblies, the bottoms, the way it was made, and it just everything just fell right into place. So it was, this is a very authentic set of luggage for the DB4. Not only do we make the suitcases custom fit, we sometimes have to make the latch assemblies, as you can see here. And that becomes a very, very time-consuming project. But there are some latch assemblies that are no longer made. They're not duplicated. We can't get them. And if we want to be really authentic, we have to make those latch assemblies. We make a number of different styles of luggage depending on the car itself. Have to use a little tiny torch. It's like making jewelry. It's fun, but it's expensive. And we prefer to buy off-the-shelf hardware as opposed to making it. It's a great deal more cost-effective for the customer, but sometimes the customer just absolutely wants it dead-on authentic, even down to the engraving on the outside of the hardware. This is a kind of a generic suitcase that we make for an automobile, and this is what we refer to as off-the-shelf hardware. This case is made out of leather with alligator binding. Here's a set of luggage that is really form-fitted to the car itself, and it matches the contours of the luggage area, so it utilizes absolutely every square inch of the luggage area. The luggage has three pieces. There's a his, a hers, and a lady's overnight case, which in this case is a champagne case. And this is one of our most popular items, is the champagne case. We have a lot of fun with this at shows, and everybody seems to like those. Is actually Bugatti champagne. Here's a three-piece set in a BMW Z8. Again, a three-piece set form-fitted to match the inside of that vehicle. We also restore picnic sets, and we make tool kits, tool rolls. We have a lot of tools. We go to Europe and here locally to buy tools at swap meets and auctions. In terms of luggage and fitted accessories for your car, we can make just about anything that you want. If your mind can come up with it, or you can find us a picture of it somewhere, we will recreate it for you. This is a briefcase that I made for myself. I wanted something that was gaudy enough that it would get people's attention and yet sophisticated enough that it could bring it was worth doing. Let me just put it that way. It was worth doing. So this took two ostrich skins and one pair of blue jeans to make. And I always get comments on it anytime I carry it, especially when I open it up and they see that there's a pair of blue jeans inside as a lining. The pockets are utilized, and we managed to reuse a lot of blue jeans that would otherwise get thrown away. Fun stuff. This is something that I really enjoy doing. If you'd like to see my briefcase, I have it with me. And after the slideshow, you're very welcome to come up, and I will open it up when we get outside here for our show and tell on the upholstery department. The jewelry on the outside is a piece of Navajo jewelry, turquoise, silver, coral, and a very large bear claw. Thank you very much for attending today, and we will move now to out into the lobby where we will look at some upholstery materials. Thank you so much for coming. I do appreciate you being here.
Before we talk about the stingray skins, I want to tell you a little bit about leather and what happens with leather. When you see an ad on television for a three-piece suite of living room furniture, 100% leather, genuine leather. It is genuine leather, absolutely, but it is the dermis as opposed to being the full top grain. Now, we thin leather out. Leather starts out thick like this, that thickness. And this is cowhide. And they slit it down and make furniture leather. They make upholstery leather. They make garment leather, shoe leather. And it's skived with a machine that cuts it thin. Now, the epidermis is very strong and hard, and that's where all the strength is. In that inexpensive living room furniture that you buy that's 100% leather, it starts to deteriorate and it gets holes in it, and you see stuff that looks like that coming out through the holes. And this is the dermis, and it has no strength to it. And that's why it's so cheap, because they take this and they coat it with a plastic coating. And it is genuine leather, but it's not the leather that you're thinking you're buying. This is actually a piece of Conley leather, and you can see that we have skived the leather in the back to thin it out. And this is what we do to make welt and nice flat seams. So anyway, when we're doing an interior, we have to have some very thin leather around the edges for binding, for welt, and so we skive, we cut it and we skive it so that we can fold it and make a very nice thin seam. Now, here's a couple of pieces of...
Do you have your own skiving?
Yes, we do. Mm-hmm. Here's a couple of different pieces of leather. I brought the snakeskin along just for fun. I have people that bring snakeskins to me, or snakes to me, every once in a while that they have killed in their yard. And I skin them, tan them, and make a hat band out of them and send it back to them. Pardon?
St. Paddy's Day mask.
Yes, yes, St. Paddy's Day mask. Uh-huh. This is a stingray, and that's his eyes that you're looking at right there. Now, this particular piece of stingray has been sanded, and then all the bumps have been smoothed out to where it's a nice, shiny surface. And when we get a stingray skin, we buy them bleached, and then we do the dyeing in-house. The stingray skin has a lot of variegation in the coloring in the skin, and so it's in its natural form with some dye on it. It shows a lot of different coloration, and if you look at the seat sitting over there on that platform by the car, you'll see the difference from one skin to the next. Now, It's a piece of material that is not terribly strong, so it has to be backed with something. So each segment of skin that we used is backed with a piece of muslin that's glued to the back of the skin. They're very, very hard to sew because this surface is like trying to sew down through a seashell. And after we finish, you can look at this. You can move it around and push on it. You're not going to hurt it. If you damage it, don't worry about it. It's a scrap. Okay? So feel it and bend it and just enjoy the experience.
That's just a polished surface. There's nothing.
It's just a polished surface that we have we've dyed the leather. The dye goes past all of these little surfaces into the leather.
It's a difficult product to work with.
Very difficult product to work with. Yes, extremely difficult. Break a lot of needles. Yes. You want to look at that, you can pass it around. Okay.
What kind of dye do you use?
We use an aniline dye with a UV protectant in it. I've tried using it just straight aniline, and it doesn't work. But it has to have a UV protectant added to it.
So it's like a permanent dye?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I've got a few cards laying out here that you're very welcome to. These are Can You Name It cards. Now, if you look at the front, it shows you the front of the car. And if you look at the back, it shows you the back end of the car. Now, if you can't name all of the cars on this, you have to go to my website to find out what they are. And these are for your buddies that know absolutely every car in the world, okay? All right, so you whip that out and say, okay, what are these cars? Well, two of them are pretty obvious as to what they are, and two of them are not so obvious, and I'm not going to tell you what they are. So you're going to have to look it up for yourself. Also, there's a couple of flyers about our Concours in La Jolla. Now, who remembers who was buried in Grant's tomb? Who said Grant? Oh, somebody else. You did. Okay. I collect memorabilia, and I think this is fun stuff. It's very inexpensive to collect paper memorabilia, but they're fun, they're entertaining, they're pretty. I have several of these. And I brought one along to give to somebody that that knows who's buried in Grant's tomb. Yes.
You're going to show your briefcase?
Oh, yeah. No, I'm not going to give it away. Ruby is enamored with my briefcase, so I promised I would show my briefcase. I needed something to take to. The Barrett Jackson auction that was gaudy and would cause people to stop and ask, where did you get that? And so that I could schlep my wares. And so I made this briefcase very, very, very rapidly. I put a piece of Navajo jewelry on the front just as a decoration. And it opens up, and then I have a sleeve in the back where I keep some of my advertisements, more propaganda. Then the inside of the briefcase, when I do briefcases, I like to do things that are fun. Sure.
That's a shark's tooth, is it?
No, that's a bear claw.
Oh, okay.
I will remain here for a while to answer questions. I think that we have just run our course. Thank you very much.